All right, today we are starting a new assignment. It has to do with vector imaging. And it is assignment 6, and we're going to be making our own logo with only black vector shapes. You have a lot of resources here you can use. I'm just going to go right to where we post it. So, because this has links to the program we're going to use. This is a free browser-based program, a lot like Photopea is a free browser-based raster program. This is a free browser-based vector program called Vectr.com. Whereas Photopea is kind of an online free version of Photoshop, Vectr.com is trying to be a free online version of Illustrator, but it is quite different than Illustrator. But in some ways, you might enjoy it more. So I'm going to go ahead and click on and open that up, and it's going to immediately take me to its welcome screen, because that's how I set up the link. And that allows us to go right into kind of introductory tutorials, which are really short, just like you're starting a new video game. And I really recommend you do them. I'm going to show you how easy it is right now. But before we do that, let's just look really closely, put it in the video. What is the difference between a raster and a vector file? So if I go back to one of my earlier assignments, this PNG file is a raster file, which means it's based on pixels. And so when I zoom in, I can see the pixels clearly. And each pixel represents, you know, the smallest unit of like a big mosaic that makes up this image. And each pixel can only be filled in with one solid color. So to turn this image into a vector, I could just replace each pixel, it would take a long time, with a square vector shape and then fill it with that color. But that's basically what a raster image already is. A vector image takes each of those pixels and it doesn't need to be locked to a square anymore. Vectors are not made with pixels. They are made with points and then curves or straight lines between the points. So you can see all those pixels, those 120 or so pixels that make up that red dot on the throat of my creature design. In a vector, it can just make a smooth red dot.
Vector looks like an oversimplified version of the pixelated image.
It's definitely simplified. It has to be simplified. Whether it's oversimplified, that's just a matter of taste, right?
When you zoom out, it's hard, difficult to tell. Like, it looks...
Yeah. So this is an extremely detailed vector image. You don't usually see this level of detail in a logo, right? So simplification is about how clearly it communicates. And so when I zoom out, because of the screen resolution, remember that this screen is made of pixels. I'm seeing pixels. Even when I'm seeing this vector, even when I'm seeing these puzzle shapes with vectors, they are made up of pixels on the screen. If I do a screen grab of it, and then I open the screen grab, just waiting for it to load. There it is. And then I zoom in on that screen grab, I'm going to see the pixels of my screen, right? So vectors don't exist on a screen. They can only be printed by laser printers to get that perfect clean cut edge that a vector gives you. And it is kind of like paint by numbers. That's a good analogy for it. So a vector defines a shape, and then you can fill that shape with any color. And what the way I want you to think about it is the most basic way vectors work is that any of those shapes can be filled with just a flat color, like you're cutting out of a big stack of colored paper. Though it is true that vectors now can be filled in with gradients as well as with flat colors. So What is the advantage? Well, when you want something that's perfectly clean, no matter the size, then you want a vector. But it is going to be simplified. And so it's ideal for logos, which usually have very limited color. And we're going to be designing just black shape logos, because a good logo should work just as a solid black shape. And then you can add color and value to it, but the core logo should always just work as just a simple black shape. So with that in mind, let's get started and try these introductory lessons, right? So you can watch this video. It's only like, I think less than 2 minutes, but I'm just gonna say get started and go right to these tools. So you should remember from exercise 2 that we used the shape tools within PhotoP, and those mimic vector tools. So the first thing it's asking is for me to use these standard shape tools, the rectangle, the rounded rectangle, or the ellipse. And I can just draw an ellipse. I can stretch it, and as soon as I let go, I'm on a trackpad, it will make the shape. If I want it to be a perfect circle, if I want it to lock its proportions, I hold down shift, and then it will lock. Now, where this is different than just using the shape tools in PhotoP is that there is no kind of warp function. There is no easy transform box. Instead, we can customize our own shapes by using what's called the pen tool. So we're going to use the pen tool a lot. And for the pen tool to work, you just click, drag, click, drag, click, drag, click, drag for straight lines. Then you click, hold, and drag to make curves. Click, hold, and drag to change the curve. And then you want to contain your path by always ending where you started. So it's a full cutout. The pencil tool we use a ton when we use Illustrator, but the pencil tool in Vectr is very simplified and not actually very useful, because it's hard, very hard to get it to contain a shape. So we're gonna do almost everything with the pen tool, which is good training for you in Vectr imaging. And then the text tool is just like a word processor, and it's fine, except the problem is there's no way to convert the text from being locked to its text files, which are called TTF files, and to get it to outline as clear vector shapes. So instead, when we add text, we're not doing text with this project, we're doing that with a later project. We're gonna use PhotoP for that and use the text tools in PhotoP, which are actually vector tools, because text is always a vector. Come on, I clicked outside it. Oh, they want me to type something, sorry. Okay. Now, how we're gonna get started with our project is we're gonna upload our sketch, right? And so you upload it with this little cloud arrow button, and you can upload a JPEG. So I can find my recent files or the ones on my desktop. You know, I can take some ink work that I did recently and I can upload it. Now that's helpful, because that's how we're going to upload our sketch in order to trace over it with vectors. And then, just like in PhotoP, we have custom shapes as well. Though they include triangles in these, but they also include, you know, multi-polygonal shapes. And then they also have some helpful kind of shortcut shapes, like teardrops. And then we can modify all of those. And then when we want to save our work, we just click here and we download it. And we're going to download it as what's called an SVG file. An SVG is a vector format. All right. It's kind of the most standard vector. It stands for standard vector graphic or something like that. Maybe system vector graphic. Let's find out. SVG stands for scalable vector graphic. And it's helpful. You can move it between multiple types of programs. Okay. That is the end of the basic kind of 10-step tutorial. And we can look at more lessons. And the ones I really recommend for you are paths and workspace tools. And then even layers will really help. We're not going to deal with gradients yet. We're not going to deal too much with images yet. And selections, if you're having trouble selecting, you can try that one. These are all short. They're all really basic. These are the tools we're going to be using to make our logo. Just these tutorials. And what I just showed you was the getting started one. If we look at the paths tutorial, it starts talking about how we modify these vectors. And this is how you're going to be drawing your graphics. So if I start drawing a path, I'll make it a combination of straight edges and curved edges. Little boomerang shape. And then I'm going to make sure to close it off by clicking where I began. So once you make a path, you can double click it and you can then see all your anchor points. And once you can see the anchor points, you can modify them. So you don't need to get it right when you first plot the path. You can also add anchor points onto the path and modify those additions. So that's all by double clicking. That's true with the shapes as well. So I can change this from a square into a new shape by dragging a path into a new position. And not only can I drag and move it to a new position, I can add new paths onto the shape. So double click, and then I can actually select multiple anchors as well, right, and modify those together. Holding down shift, I can select multiple points. In Illustrator, they're called anchor points. This just calls them points, right? And if we select one and then hold down shift, select multiples, we get this little box. And it shows us we have multiple that we can shift at a time. See what it wants me to do. Now I can delete multiple anchors at a time. So if you click and hit delete, it will remove one of your points. If we double click a point, it will convert it from being straight edged to being curved. And then once it's curved, you can actually edit the curves. And if I double click on a point here where there are curves, it will change it back to being straight. Double click to convert to a curve. Hold shift while editing your curve. And it can change the length of the curve just on one side. If you don't hold down shift, it will change them on both sides symmetrically. If I hold down shift, I can just weight it on one side. And then if I hold down on a Mac, it's the command button. On a PC, it's the control button. I can actually change the angle and the length independently by holding down command or control. Okay, double click. So when you have rounded corners, like the rounded rectangle tool, you can click and drag this inner point, which isn't actually an anchor point, it's a control point. And you can change the what they call the corner radius. And if I hold shift, it will change all of them at the same time on that shape. Okay. So we got through two of the basic tutorials in this first video. And so now's a good time to bring in our sketch and actually start building with the Vectr program. So before you bring in your sketch, I want you to post it to Canvas. So I've posted mine here.